Today we're going to address one of the most profound puzzles in all of biology. We want to ask, where does life come from? So today we're going to be looking at the origin of life. And I want to take a very mechanistic viewpoint, focusing on the very building blocks of life itself. We want to ask, which came first? Was it the RNA, the DNA, or could it have been the proteins? The ancient Greeks believed that life came up from nothing, that at the bottom of the great chain of being, inanimate matter wished to be alive and would make the struggle up through being lower plants to higher plants to birds to people. But can life really come from nothing over and over again? Or does life only come from pre-existing forms? Something from nothing? Why would people think that? Well, they did for a very long time. And a very famous study in early biology was by this man, Jan van Helmont, in 1620, who said, if you press a piece of underwear soiled with sweat together with some wheat in an open-mouthed jar, after about 21 days, the odor changes, and the ferment coming out of the underwear and penetrating through the husks of the wheat changes the wheat into mice. Ta-da! So, here's his experiment. Sweaty underwear in an open-mouthed jar with some wheat. And amazing, this generates mice. Extraordinary. And hey, he went on to say, what's more remarkable is that mice of both sexes emerge and successfully reproduce with mice born naturally from parents. It's incredible. What's even more remarkable is that the mice which came out were not small mice, but fully grown. They came from nothing to be full-grown mice. Incredible. Well, it wasn't for another 60 or 70 years that somebody started, well, let's test some of these ideas about where organisms come from. So the notion that fully formed animals might appear spontaneously from nothing led to the world's first controlled experiment by an Italian named Francesco Redi in 1688. Now at the time, people believed that flies were generated by rotting meat. They actually emerged out of the meat itself. So he's famous because he actually used a control group. So instead of having just an open-mouthed jar filled with dirty underwear and wheat, he has two jars, one that's open to the outside and the other with a plug on it. And so if flies really could be generated from rotting meat themselves, he should have gotten flies in both flasks. But, of course, the flies only came from those that had an opening to the outside world. The flies, and indeed the mice, in the previous experiment, came in from somewhere else. They were not generated there. They were already around. So we know that these complex things obviously have got parents. They've got moms and dads somewhere else. But it's not such a crazy idea to think that life might originate from nothing, because after all, you look at ponds and you might look at your soup that you cooked a few weeks ago and it's still sitting out and there's scum and there's slime. That seems to come out of nowhere. Is that just emerging spontaneously from whatever substance it happens to be sitting on? And this led to the experiments of one of the most famous scientists in the 19th century, Louis Pasteur. Louis Pasteur was actually interested in how things might grow that were invisible until there was enough of them on a surface that we'd say, oh, look at that. There's the scum. There's the slime. Where'd that come from? So he did an experiment that's an awful lot like Francesco Redi's. But the first thing he wanted to do was to make sure there was nothing living in a beaker that might have some food in it. So this is basically a media, like a soup or a broth. And so he boils it to make sure there's nothing alive in there. And then it's sterilized. So here it is, there's nothing in there. And if there's access to the open air, though, there's recontamination. If there's things floating around in the air that can get back in through the top. So he had another experiment where he had the same thing, that there would be access of air in and out, but it's a complex tube, so things couldn't easily pass in from the outside. So again, first, boil it, make sure it's sterilized, but there's no recontamination. So no scum, no slime in here, okay? Now, this is a profound experiment for the time, because this said, you know, there are things out there in the air. We can't see them, but they're there. So this gave Pasteur the notion of what we now call germ theory. that diseases are caused by microorganisms, caused by organisms too small to see with the naked eye. And in fact, germ theory was one of the most important advances in science for hundreds of years. So if life comes in from outside these flasks, and if the mice came in from outside the dirty sweat bowl, where did life come from originally? It had to get started sometime. All living things that we see today, we can use DNA to say, yep, they've got ancestors. That baby bacteria had mommy bacterias and would go a long way back. Everything that we see has got ancestors. Life does not generate from inanimate objects. There is not this inherent striving of inanimate matter to become alive. It doesn't happen. But life did have to start somewhere. And we do have to take seriously the problem that at some point in Earth's history, there was nothing, and suddenly there's life.